again, thank you for being with us, panelists and staff, and all of our special guests who have joined from the outside community for the Best Buddies International 2022 Black History Month program. My name is Joseph Canty. I'm our Director of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. We had a minor technical delay today, but we moved forward, so I'm very thankful here. With us, I'm going to move and introduce our panelists. We have Kelli Howard. She will be on with us momentarily, otherwise known affectionately as Kelli Boo. She has been volunteering with us since 2009, if I'm not mistaken, through our Buddies program, and has constantly progressed in her work with Best Buddies, and is a huge advocate for our work and a true leader in her community. She resides in Tampa, Florida, and she is absolutely an amazing blessing to this organization. Just in a short time, I've had a chance to talk to Kelli. She is not only a light, but a true inspiration to me as a colleague, and also just excited for some of her work that she's going to be doing with us as well in the social media space, and continue to move forward her advocacy for Best Buddies International and individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities all over the world. We also have with us Elle Smith, who was a 2021 Miss USA winner, and we're excited to have her join us. I haven't met her yet, so pleasure to meet you. She comes to us through doing some great advocacy work for some great advocacy work over the last year, I believe. And just her partnership and her passion and some of the information Mark Wylie shared with me. Elle, I'm excited to have you join us. We did share a little bit about your bio. I am trying to be a little more concise because of the time frame. So please, thank you for your grace there. We also have Jennifer Jones Austin, who is an attorney, but also comes to us doing some great advocacy work out of the great state of New York, my hometown, Bronx, New York, but she has done a number of great things. We'll get into more of that as we get into questions with each of the panelists about their background and the work they're doing. We also have with us Michale Boley, who is an advocate, parent in this space, but also a former professional athlete who really, I think, will share a very interesting perspective as how he's balanced that in being dad, but also making sure he's supporting his children along their journey who have IDD as well. So I'm excited for you all to hear from him. And then we also have Brittany Portier. Brittany, I apologize for the mispronunciation of your name if I got it wrong in the spelling, but I want to make sure of that. She is a programming manager and part of our mission expansion team based out of the Miami, Florida area. And then we have with us Jessica Wylie as well, who's going to help in the background and lend another staff voice to this conversation, who's been with us for a little over 3 years now. As you all know, she has done some great work and is our employee of the year here at Best Buddies. So we're excited to have her join us. Yeah, myself is serving as moderator, and you have the great Wylie, who's with us and supporting all things and has been a true support of this work and continue to be a longtime staff member here at Best Buddies International. So I'm going to move forward into the panel, and I'm going to ask you all, just give me a second to make sure I let, I've got to let Kelli in, and then we will get going here.
I'm here.
You're here. All right. So we're going to spotlight you. Pleasure to have you. Yeah, I love it. I love when a plan comes together. It is exciting to have you with us, Kelli. So I'm going to ask you all your first question, and folks, I will share the questions. I think it's important for you to see them. And panelists, we're going to go in the order that you see your names. Jessica, I have you being the last one. Once you join, if you are here, you can certainly just let me know. I know you were having some delays in the office where you're at. Kelli, you'll respond first. Elle, Jennifer, Michale, Brittany, Jessica. So we'll go in that order. So what is one interesting fact about you the audience might not know after a Google search?
My favorite one I like to use is I'm actually a quarter Japanese. So I have a little bit of flavor in there, if you will.
Okay.
So all right. I'll share that something that you would not pick up on social media or Google. I was born in 1968, in the fall of 1968, and I attended Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s funeral in April of 1968. How did that happen? I went in utero in my mommy's.
I love it. I love it. Well, that is an interesting fact. No one would ever Google or guess that one. Thank you for sharing that with us, Jennifer. I'd imagine you probably have some interesting experiences to share through your parents' lenses. So thanks for offering that up. Elle, love to know something that's a fun fact about yourself that we might not otherwise find online.
It's a fun fact that I just learned recently. So I grew up in Ohio, actually, and then I went to school in Kentucky, won Miss Kentucky USA, and then won Miss USA. But I found out recently through Ancestry.com that I had slave ancestors who were on a plantation in Kentucky. And so the fact that I ended up winning Miss Kentucky USA was kind of ironic. We had a family discussion about it. So it's a fun fact that I just learned and I get to share with y'all.
Well, thank you. I'm glad. That's interesting. I love to learn more about that. All right, Mike, what's a fun fact about yourself that we might not otherwise find online?
Oh, man. I guess given that I'm an athlete, I guess you wouldn't be able to read that I grew up loving music. I was really into music when I was a kid. So I played the piano for a couple of years. Might not can tell from my size, but I played the violin as well. And I played saxophone because I was a big Kenny G fan growing up. So that's something you won't find.
Makes two of us. Makes two of us. Okay. All right. Thanks for sharing that. Kenny G fan there. Brittany, what is a fun fact you'd love to share?
I actually found out something interesting yesterday. A majority of my staff here in South Florida know that outside of Best Buddies, I am a professional race car driver in both the NHRA and the IHRA. But I found out yesterday, I had an interview with ESPN and they did research, and I'm one of the only Black women in the US that have their own drag race and performance company. So I didn't know that. I'm always focused on the athletic aspect of it, but I never really thought about the professional as far as my company aspect. So that's kind of a fun fact that I found out yesterday that I get to share with you guys.
Now that's awesome. That's a pretty cool one. So I want to learn more about that myself, and I look forward to hearing more about it. You shared some things I didn't know from my own son they can get involved with. So that's great to hear. Great to hear. Mrs. Wylie, any fun facts you'd like for us to share? I know you can't turn your video on just yet, but we'd love to hear from you if you're available. Okay, she's
not with us. Everyone, sorry about that. Okay. We were having a little bit of issues. I'm actually in Vegas right now at the office here, and we're just having some issues, but super excited. I missed the intros. Wow, Joe, just to do a fun fact, let's see. I think a fun fact about myself that you probably don't know is I was actually able to go to Jerry Jones's home and have dinner with him. And I think that's pretty cool. I got to learn a lot about him and his family. Not a Cowboys fan, but I really enjoyed that experience.
That is a very cool fact. I wouldn't have never guessed that one, but I do know you like sports. That's awesome. That's awesome. Good to hear. Good to hear. I'd be curious to hear more about when he thinks they're going to win the Super Bowl. For all the Cowboys fans out there. I'm sorry, I couldn't resist, folks. next question we have for you all. We're going to delve a little bit into our discussion, and here's our first prompt. Kelli, what does Black History Month mean to you? And how does it inspire you as a person?
It means American history. I feel like sometimes if we didn't have slavery, we wouldn't have empowering men and women creating all these great inventions that we use on a day-to-day life to make our lives a lot easier. So it is our American history. And it inspires me to feel better.
Thank you for sharing that, Kelli. Indeed, it is American history. Thank you. Elle, when you think about Black History Month, what does it mean to you?
Black History Month to me is a reflection period, but also a celebration period. We reflect on where we started, where we are now, and where we are going to go and where we need to go. But it's also a celebration of everything in the African-American diaspora, all of our accomplishments, just how dope we are as a Black community and everything in that. So that's a celebration aspect.
Thank you for sharing that. Jennifer, You think about Black History Month.
I echo the sentiments and the thoughts of both Ellen and Kelli. And I'll add that as I am maturing in life, I'm also appreciating that it's during Black History Month that I'm not just reflecting on, you know, what the contributions have been by other people to our society, but what am I doing? And how am I showing up? And so, you know, what I tell myself and what I tell my children and others around us is that, you know, living today, I am tomorrow's Black history. And so I'm constantly centering on, you know, how am I showing up? What am I doing? Because if I do what I should be doing, then I will be, you know, essentially, you know, setting the legacy that will be talked about by my children, my grandchildren, and their grandchildren, and perhaps others in the days and the months and the years to come.
Thank you so much for sharing that. And all three of you, sharing your thoughts on what Black History Month means. Next up, we have Mike. What does Black History Month mean to you? How does it inspire you as a person?
It means a lot to me. I mean, for me, if most of you don't know, I grew up in Alabama. And the part of Alabama I grew up in, we didn't learn much about Black history. So a lot of my Black history learning, which is American history, is just left out in some areas. I didn't learn a lot about it when I was young, except for my parents. My parents did a good job of making sure that we knew things about our history that just weren't being told to us. And so it's something for me, you know, I still try to pass it down, and I try to teach my kids things that they may learn in school, things they may not. So it's big for me.
Thank you, indeed. Brittany.
Black History Month means to me celebrating the blueprint of the nation. If you look back in history and you look at all of our forefathers and those that who have paved the way for all of us with inventions and like George Washington Carver and things of that nature, you know, they've kind of created the blueprint. Everything that you associate today with yourself, even from the coffee mugs that you drink out of, to the comb that you comb your hair with every single day, and your hair care products, it's all a part of Black history. So when you look at Black history, it's not just Black history, it is American history. So I believe it not only means a lot to me, it means so much to each and every one of us because of those individuals in our past. It's created who all of us are today in the present. So that's what it means to me.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that and your thoughts there. Ms. Wylie, you're with us. Thank you for joining us. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for joining us. So love to have you just kind of piggyback on what our other panelists have shared, and love to know what Black History Month means to you, and how does it inspire you as a person?
Yeah, definitely. Well, I, you know, echo everything that everyone else has said, you know, really just being about American history. And I think for me, it's a time really that we can reflect. You know, I think about walking through Target and really seeing a lot of the merchandise that's Black history, and we really get to see the culture. You know, for me, Black History Month is, you know, every month, but excited that in February, it's a time where as a world and as a society, we can all come together. We visually get to see it. And I think for me, you know, how does it inspire me? I think it's just a reminder of, you know, what the other panelists have said, the things that have been done before me. And then also, what am I doing today, you know, so that I can make my mark and, you know, hopefully be, you know, part of Black history for other folks to come.
Sounds good. Thank you for sharing that. I love the fact that you're talking about, you know, creating a path for the next generation of leaders, next generation of people who can be inspiring just as you all are. Thank you. Thank you so much. Our next question for you all as panelists, is there a particular place in history that stands out to you when you think about Black history? And if so, what is that person, place, or time in history? Kelli?
I believe Madam C.J. Walker. She stands out to me the most, not only because she's a, you know, a phenomenal woman, but I'm very much involved in hair and all things makeup, and I always feel like her model is my model. I feel like once you feel good about yourself, you can advocate for yourself better and, you know, be a presence to everyone. So that's why I think where she was coming from, but I love her ambition and all the things she did for the Black community and Black women.
Well said, well said. Elle?
For me, I would say the summer of 2020, specifically being in Louisville with all the racial injustice and the protest, I think being there, it changed obviously the world and sparked a different conversation. But for me personally, being a biracial woman, it sparked conversations within my family, with my white side of the family and my Black side of the family. And I think that's what we could take away from that summer. So it was an integral part in history when we look back, but also for me personally, in the way that I navigated those conversations.
I appreciate you saying that, just talking about how it's important to, one, pick up on the nuances and how you do navigate discussions and ways that you make reference to your own diaspora. So thank you for sharing that. Thank you. Next person up, Ms. Austin.
So I'll share that there have been stories that I've heard of, history lessons that I've learned through the years. And, you know, there have been people kind of like, you know, the activism from Ida B. Wells, who, you know, was a journalist and in the late 1800s said, you know what, these lynchings of Black people, you know, I'm going to stand up and speak out about it, using her voice, to the Black women, you know, who were engaged in the suffragist movement and were like, you know what, we're not going to let white women tell us that we can't have the white right to vote, and we're going to step forward and we're going to bring forth the vote for everybody. So I've drawn a lot of inspiration from persons like that, but having a father who was president of the New York chapter of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference when King was president of the National Southern Christian Leadership Conference. My dad was president of Operation Breadbasket, which was the economic justice arm. Together, King and he and about eight other persons founded the Progressive National Baptist Convention. Growing up and hearing these stories and seeing my father, you know, engaged in activism, I grew up down the street. I lived two doors down from Shirley Chisholm. My point in sharing all this is that, like, Black history and activism was like always in my orbit. And so while I draw inspiration from these women and these stories that I heard, you know, for like 100 years past, it was kind of like the active engagement always like becoming part of my DNA. And frankly, that's what I believe when I think about what the work that we're doing now. And when Ellen talked about what's happening with, you know, what happened in 2020, those are the things that, like, when we see others engaged and we see everyday people, that's what kind of motivates and inspires us everyday persons to think that we can be a part. And so, I mean, I guess I drew inspiration from that moment, seeing my dad and others engaged, but it's just that everyday citizen, individual, that I think we can always, whatever the time period is, draw inspiration from.
Well said. Thank you very much. Brittany? Oh, Michael, excuse me. Sorry, I apologize. We'll come right back to you.
Me or Brittany, do you want to go?
You.
Do you want to go? I mean, to kind of piggyback on what's already been said, a lot of the stuff that happened in 2020 and since, you know, it kind of, like you said, it sparked the conversation. So for me, like I said, I grew up in an area that, you know, a lot of that, you know, I didn't grow up in a diverse area. You know, I was predominantly white area, and a lot of those people didn't like people of color. And so it sparked a conversation that I've been able to talk to people just over the last few years, being able to go back home and sit down and like get other people's perspective of how they view things. And it's kind of opened my eyes and I like to think that I've opened some other people's eyes to a different perspective on how things have been. And so, you know, I think that's something that I've been kind of grateful for the last couple of years.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing those thoughts. It just a reminder that we all grow up in different spaces and the impact, and that definitely has an impact on how we see the world, but then also we can make a choice and how we navigate moving forward. Elle, I think you spoke on that a minute ago, and Jessica, you as well. So thank you all for sharing that. Brittany, you're up next.
I kind of like what Jessica said. I feel as though I feel as though it has really been in my DNA as far as fighting for equal rights in the Black community. As you guys know, I am a direct descendant of the late Sir Sidney Poitier, which his father and my grandfather's father were brothers. So to have such a strong legacy and to see his fight when it came to not only acting, you know, being a Black actor during that time and, you know, fighting for equality and walking beside Dr. Martin Luther King in 1967. I do believe Dr. Martin Luther King even paid homage to him. To seeing some of the advocacy being done, even in my own family who fought in South Florida for Black rights. And, you know, I feel as though we all have a due diligence to fight for equity, equality, access for all of us. You know, we need to take what we've learned from our ancestors and you know, look at some of the things that they have taught us over the years and use that to apply to our journey here in the present, even when working with Best Buddies. Best Buddies were kind of hit with a double whammy. You know, I'm an IDD mom. I have a son with autism and he's 6'4" and he's 14. So now I have a Black son who has special needs and he can be seen as a threat in society, mm-hmm. you know? So what we need to do here at Best Buddies is we need to take everything that we've learned from our past and those who have fought and advocated for equality and apply them to our equitable work as well. Use that to stand on and let's push this mission forward. So I thank God for everybody who's been there before us to fight, and we just have to keep the fight going.
Thank you. That's a beautiful transition to Ms. Wylie and to our next question.
Yeah, I think, you know, whenever I think about a specific example or moment in time that stands out, you know, I don't know if it's because it's so recent, but I definitely agree with Elle. You know, going back to 2020, I think that it's just something that is so recent. But for me, it was also the opportunity to start those conversations, as, you know, I think Michael had said, but then also it was a moment of just reflection of, you know, things that you learned while you were growing up, having those, you know, conversation, whether it's, you know, with your family members, friends, peers. So I think that's probably the most specific example that stands out to me.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you. Thank you for you all offering your insight into just that specific place and time or person in history that really influenced where you are in the space in terms of your own diaspora. I am going to move to our next question, folks, and then we will try to move this along so we can be mindful of time. So thank you all as panelists. This next question is actually an open discussion prompt, and I am excited about this. And Brittany, you helped us move into this question beautifully, so thank you. All right, so here's our next prompt. Let's talk a little bit about the importance of representation, identity, and diversity. How would you describe the three? Kelli, would love to hear from you on this one.
Okay, I was talking to Joe about it the other day. I really love this one because I feel like I am the representation for a lot of the people of a minority and a person with IDD. I was the first one in my chapter to do a lot of the things first, and it paved the way for a lot of the younger audience to say, hey, if she can do that, I would love to do that. So I've been that kind of voice of reason. Even for the parents, I've talked to so many parents along the way of my career in Best Buddies, and they go, oh, they can do this after high school, or, you know, there's something for them after college. Like, they don't have to just sit and be a couch potato, but being able to be that, you know, the set stone where they can find something that they can do as they get older, I think that's awesome. And then a person with IDD doing all of it, they can relate to that as well.
Thank you, Kelli. Elle?
I would say all those three things are so incredibly important, but they're also so intertwined. But representation specifically is so important to me, but more specifically accurate representation, because I've realized that misrepresentation is more harmful than no representation at all. And so for me, I don't think I really understood the power that I should say representation has until I won Miss USA. And I had women, I had little girls, I had little boys messaging me, and my win represented so much to them. And for me, I always just feel like L, you know, I just feel like a normal person, but to get those messages and for people to see themselves in me, it meant a lot. But also it thought I had to think about who did I see myself in the pageant world before me. And that was Chesley Christ. You know, she was a woman who occupied space. She wasn't afraid of that. She was authentically herself in everything that she did. And as a Black woman, I wanted to be exactly like her. I wanted to emulate her in so many ways. So that's what I would say.
Mirrors and windows. That's what I think about when I hear what you're saying. Thank you for sharing that. Jennifer?
I often think about when I hear those words and people talk about those words, the importance of us disregarding and putting to the side the American metaphor, we are a melting pot. We are not a melting pot. It's often been said, you know, that we're not a melting pot. We are actually a stew, and we should center on being a stew. When a stew is created, you know, the potatoes don't blend into being like carrots and potatoes and the meat or whatever, the celery, everything retains its original form and contributes to the, you know, the good taste of a stew. We should see ourselves as a stew, Black, white, Indigenous persons, persons of Asian descent. And even in that, the other point is that we're not a monolith. All Blacks are not the same. You know, all people of Asian descent are not the same. And so, you know, when we lean into representation, identity, and diversity, we need to appreciate that as well. And I'll also just add to that, and just because I'm Black and I show up at the table doesn't mean that I'm necessarily riding for all Black people. And we need to understand that as well.
All very important points. I will transition right to Mr. Boley. Thank you.
When I hear those three words, I think about how, they all go together. Especially for me. One thing that I've always tried to do throughout my life, especially playing sports, is who do I represent? What do I represent? One thing that I've always, me and some friends have always told us is like, what's your identity? And so, you know, it was kind of one of those things that, you know, we've kind of harped on, like, who do you want to be? Like, don't be the person that they want you to be. Like, show everybody who you are. And so just in doing that, that's something that I've tried to carry, like, throughout my life so far. And I try to, I've had conversations with my kids about that. Some of my kids are older now. And so, I try to get them to make sure they always carry themselves the right way.
Thank you. Brittany?
Oh, there we go. Computer didn't want to unmute for me. So representation, identity, and diversity is so very important, especially for me, because I have, you know, if you look at society and you look at the stereotypes, I have a lot of stereotypes that is against me. If you look at society standard. So for one, I was a young teen mom. That's one thing. I am a Black woman in the United States. That's another thing, because being a Black woman has always been kind of like a negative connotation that goes along with it. Being raised, you know, even though I have the last name of Portier, I did not have Sydney Portier's money. So being raised in the environment that I was in, I feel like as an adult now, and even in my line of work outside of Best Buddies, when I'm racing, when I'm traveling the country, it is very important that I represent myself in a way of, respect, honor. Also inspiring people and letting them know, you know, hey, as far as African American or Black or even our Hispanic people, brothers and sisters, you know, it's not where you come from that defines who you are. It's who you are internally. So don't allow negative connotations or negative labels to attach itself to your identity. So that's something that I feel is very important, is, you know, always projecting yourself as who you are, being a strong individual, you know, being proud of your identity, and always letting people know that, you know, just because I am Black or I am of an island descent or I was a single mom, you know, that doesn't mean that I'm destined for failure. So that's what I feel is important, representation of diversity and identity.
Thank you for sharing that. I am going to, Ms. Wylie, we'd love to hear from you on this, and then we'll transition into our next prompt.
Yeah, so I think to sum up this specific prompt, one thing that really stood out to me was actually something that Joe shared with our staff last month in our buddy beat. So I'm actually going to read it. I refer to this as mirrors and windows, being able to see myself through the experiences of other people who look like me and can identify with my experiences. That was something that he actually shared in a blog post earlier this month for our buddy beat. And it really stood out to me, really the whole concept of mirrors and windows. And I know it just mentioned it, really being able to look out of the mirrors and windows and see myself. But then I also look at myself now that I'm in a, you know, at an age now where they're young girls, and I hope that they can see themselves in me and that I can be a role model to them, because I think the representation for young Black girls is so important. You know, growing up, you know, making sure that there was representation from a Barbie doll or a baby doll that may have the same skin color as me. And so I think that the mirrors and windows, excuse me, is really important to me.
Thank you. Thank you for saying that. And I appreciate the quote there. It is indeed a special reference to me in terms of my own identity, which brings us to, I think, a shift in our discussion on our panel today. I want to talk a little about our mission and our organization and what we stand for, and then all of you and your work and what you're doing. And I'd love to ask you, just in general, you know, when you think about some of the challenges that are facing the IDD community as a whole, but you particularly the Black community, what are some of the challenges that you see in your work to further advocate for individuals in the IDD community, particularly in the Black community? And I'd like to kind of go through each of you. This is a question that you'd like to answer, but as I've shared with you all prior to, think about your own experience, both professionally and personally. And then we'll go to the second question of this prompt. So Kelli, would you like to share anything here?
Can you repeat that one more time, Joe?
Yes. What are some of the challenges that you see in terms of being able to advocate for individuals within the Black community who have IDD?
Thank you. For myself personally, I think not looking the part is a big challenge of mine. I've had incidents over the years where people wouldn't take me seriously when I needed help the most. For instance, I was at an airport and I needed assistance through the airport, and the lady almost ignored me until I got, you know, my chauffeur on the other end to contact them. Kind of go to almost three different people just to, you know, find help. Or when I used to work in the dining hall, they would put me in places like counting money or cooking, things I'm not good at. And I would say, you know, because of my IDD, I can't, you know, do certain things. But I don't look the part, they don't give me the tools that I need. So I think that's a lot of the challenges that I've had over the years. But as being an advocate and a global ambassador now, speaking up more, I think able to find those obstacles less challenging now as I'm older. But back in the day, I mean, there's still a part of my life where I have to work hard at day to day, if that makes sense. But as far as like learning how to do things on my own, I just keep trying and trying until I get it right.
Well, that's so important, Kelli. I think that perseverance is indeed why you're the inspiration you are now. So thank you for sharing that.
Thank you.
I'm going to shift a little bit, panelists. So I'm going to ask particularly to Mike and Brittany in regards to, as parents who have children with intellectual and developmental disabilities, I'd love for you all to just kind of share your perspective on what are some of the challenges you see in supporting and advocating for your children, but you're also dealing with the intersectionality of being Black while trying to find ways to advocate for them as well. Love to hear from you both.
Well, I mean, for me, it was challenging to start, you know, back. I got custody of my son when he was 5. And at the time, to be honest, I didn't know anything about autism or what he was dealing with. And so it was a lot for me. I guess the resources to me were limited. And at the time I was fortunate to know the owner of the Atlanta Falcons. His former Home Depot partner was, he owned the Marcus Institute in Atlanta. And so I was able to actually get my son in and both get him the help he needed, but also get me the education that I needed, and which stuff like that wasn't readily available, you know, for people who looked like me, who weren't in my position. And so, you know, stuff like that is hard, and it's a little better now, but I think that with some of the help and some of the work that I've done just over the years, you know, working with Autism Speaks, you know, for a number of years, being able to, like, for me, just showing up, having somebody who looks like me there, letting people know it's okay to, you know, get involved. So, okay.
Thank you for sharing that and being vulnerable. Thank you. Brittany.
Earlier, my son, now he's 14. So it's my little gentle giant, my 6'4" gentle giant.
You talked about that.
Right.
Elaborate on that for us. Talk to us about that experience and as a parent.
So, you know, as a mom of a child, I actually have 3 children with diagnosed with an IDD. So my son, he has, my 14-year-old has autism spectrum disorder. I have a 7-year-old son who has ADHD. And then my daughter, who is 16 years old, she has dyslexia. So I'm kind of like all over the board when it comes to being an IDD mom. And some challenges that you do face is, you know, finding that support, especially 14 years ago, when there weren't a lot of resources. There were programs like Best Buddies and so many other entities out there. But in low socioeconomic environments, you didn't hear so much about them. And that's because of various reasons. We at Best Buddies, we have to crack the code. And that's something that myself and Mr. Canty have talked about. I come from Broward County Public Schools, and I've worked there for over 15 years. And one of my main concentrations was equity, access, and diversity. So when it comes to cracking the code and really supporting families like myself and Mr. Michael, you know, are you willing to do the work? What do you mean, Brittany, by saying, are you willing to do the work? Are you willing to do your research? Are you willing to do data for your schools, your Title I schools? Are you willing to immerse yourself in their culture? Because remember, we're talking about equity, diversity. So that doesn't just mean our Black students, that mean our brown students. You know, so if you're in a fully diverse environment, you know, are you willing to tap into their world in the Black community and in other communities? It's, you know, having a special needs is taboo in the family. They don't like to talk about it because they see it as, you know, like a spiritual hindrance. You have our Haitian culture who, you know, practice Catholicism, and you have so many other cultures like that. So that means you have to build that trusting relationship. So as Best Buddy workers trying to push this program out there and push this organization out there, are you going to go into the communities? Are you going to, like in psychology, because my background, I have a master's degree in counseling. Are you going to meet them where they're at? So that means getting outside of that comfort zone of that office, going to some of the churches, talking to families, you know, going to some of these community events, building that relationship so that you can break those barriers and so that we can help families like myself and Mr. Michael with our children. I think back 14 years ago, if I had someone to come in, even if they didn't look like me, you know, if they came in and showed that they truly cared by connecting with who I was, my culture, and my environment around me, it would have made me more comfortable to connect with them. And possibly my son may have would have been in Best Buddies a lot sooner than he is now, because now my son is a part of Best Buddies. So that is some of the barriers, and we can break those barriers by starting with us working in this organization, you know, busting open those doors and creating those relationships in the community.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to shift to the next question. And I just want to say this, understanding the needs of each community is an important step in engaging with communities that we're not already involved with. And I think another important part of that is when we start to listen and our hearts and minds are open, that's when trust is built and that's when the magic happens. That's when you have a truly long-standing relationship. So thank you, Brittany, for sharing that. I'd like to transition over to Elle, Jennifer, and Jessica. I'd love to ask you all this question in particular. And so when we think about this question and what's needed, as individuals who are engaged in communities all over the country, what advice can you offer our staff community on value of representation and developing those relationships to break down barriers, both within the IDD community, but also beyond that? Elle, we'll start with you.
I think Brittany just talked about it, the importance of, you know, people at the end of the day just want to be seen and, you know, meeting someone where they're at. So I think that's important if you're wanting to build these relationships is, you know, connect with these people, see where they are, listen to what they're saying, but also educate yourself. Like, I understand that I can only do so much. I don't know everything. I don't have a child with IDD. And so educating myself and, you know, asking questions and being the best advocate that I can be is what I do every single day. But then it goes back to just people are always going to remember how you made them feel. So, you know, being courteous in regards to your relationship and making people feel seen.
Thank you.
Two thoughts for me. The first is the importance of creating community. I remember as a little girl, there was a young lady, a little girl, similar age, who lived down the street from us. Now I say street because I live in Brooklyn, right? She lived down the street from us. And she had an IDD. You know, as young persons, we didn't know exactly what was her challenge, but we knew that she was challenged in some way. My sister and myself, along with two of our good friends, we always made sure, and our parents made sure, that Rosalind was a part of our posse. And, you know, like everything from learning to jump double dutch, you know, to like walking to the corner store to get ices on a hot summer day. There was like, we were each uniquely made and different, but we all had value. And I just remember like that, like how that, my parents taught me something in those early years about, you know, like Roz's worth was no less than my worth, and that we all were part of community. So I think creating community is critically important. And then tied to that, picking up on something else that, you know, we talk a lot about how people should not be speaking for us, you know, how all through the years, you know, whether it is in policy making or programming, that, you know, like there are people who sit at the table who suggest that they know what the Black community needs, right? Or, you know, like what is best. And very often we weren't at the table. And so I think it's critically important that persons with IDD be at the table. As Elle said, speaking for themselves. And yes, they can have ambassadors with them and partners, but we should dare not believe, unless it's a conversation where you're being asked as a caregiver, a parent too, but not, you know, what is the experience? You can't speak for me, and we should not pretend that we can speak for persons with IDD.
Thank you. Well said. Very important statement to make. Ms. Wylie.
Hey, I know we're getting close to the Q&A, so I'll keep this short. I definitely saw where someone just said that Kelli is a great example, and I definitely agree there. I think we are all giving her praise. Agree with what everyone has said. Elle and Jennifer. I think for me, it's also just realizing that everyone has a different experience, and we can't compare any two people. It doesn't matter race, ethnicity, if we're talking about ability, disability. But I think it's also being able to listen to someone. We don't always have to have the answers. It's sometimes taking that time to sit back and listen and gather that information. And then finally, I just put on here also just to be yourself. I think oftentimes we end up in these conversations and not knowing what to do or trying to feel like we have to fit in a certain way. But I think just being able to listen, show up, and be yourself are important things for me. Hey, Joe, I think you're still.
Yeah, you're fine. I just cut it back on. Thank you for sharing that so much. Folks, we're going to move. We have one last question for our panelists, and we're going to move right into our Q&A. We may go over a minute here, a few minutes. We do appreciate your time with us. And really fast, what I'd love to ask you all, we're going to move past one question. But if there's one person that you can think about who inspires you when you think about Black history, who would that person be and why? Kelli, we'll start with you.
I think I might have touched on it a little bit earlier in this segue, but probably Madam C.J. Walker, because I feel like I said earlier, if it wasn't for her, aspiring to create hair care products and feeling good about yourself and being an advocate for yourself, I feel like that is leadership in many ways. And as far as for me, I feel like I fit that mold for my chapter, my organization, because if it wasn't for me, I wouldn't have paved the way for a lot of younger viewers, a lot of younger buddies, and parents, like I said earlier. I've done a lot of the first, being a global ambassador, being a leader, just traveling for best buddies, and, talking to parents, because I know that can be hard for some peers of mine to talk to parents, but I think I have a gift of gab, so I don't feel shy around, adults or things like that, or just taking the initiative in creating fun activities for my group. Like, I'm always thinking ahead of time. Just sharing the mission anywhere I go. I'm sure my family gets annoyed by it by now, but just being that leadership role and making sure I keep it going as far as like winning awards and speaking at different venues and just being humble about it too. Don't let it go over my head too much, but it is a fun way of getting out there, networking and speaking to people is my hobby. So it's a lot of fun for myself.
Well, there's nothing wrong with that. And I appreciate you just sharing that. Thank you, Kelli.
Thank
you so much. Elle, we'd love to hear from you.
For me, I'm going to go back to Chesley in regards to the pageant world. She was Miss USA 2019, and I remember sitting in bed watching Pizza when she won, and it was such a big moment for me because it was the first time that I ever saw myself in a Miss USA winner, and then that year ended up being historical year for pageants because Miss USA was Black, Miss Teen USA was Black, and Miss America was Black, and they covered Essence, they covered all these amazing magazines, and I wanted to be like them. And so I remember that moment, and for me, she was just a powerful Black woman who was just so incredibly smart and everything that she did. And so for me, that's my girl and who I wanted to emulate in every way in the pageant world.
Thank you for sharing.
Jennifer? I realize, Alma, I think I'm just sitting here so enamored by all of these women. And I'm like, it's all of them. just phenomenal, phenomenal women. And I'll just say that I think it's been the Black women in history who found their voices, who at a time when it was not acceptable for Black women to have a voice. So Ida B. Wells, Sojourner Truth, Maya Angelou, Fannie Lou Hamer, and the list goes on and on and on. just Black women who essentially, and Brittany spoke to this in some ways, who were not just experiencing racism, but were experiencing misogyny and sexism, even from Black men, but who found a way to, you know, like bring their voices to court and speak truth to power. I'll quickly share with you, my mother grew up in the South. Young Black woman, when she was 7, 8 years old, she said she grew up in Louisville, Kentucky, Elle, and she said that she wanted to be engaged in the arts when she grew up. And her counselors, her teachers told her that that was not a career for a little Black girl, especially one in the South. And she went on to become the first Black and the first Black woman to be the art curator for a Fortune 500 company, traveling the world, buying and commissioning artwork to hang all around this nation, right, to display. And she found voice for Black people who were not making it into the mainstream art places. So I guess what I'm saying to you is that it's these women, these Black women who had to endure so much, not just racism. Fannie Lou Hamer, who didn't have a voice at the table during the civil rights movement, but she put herself there. Shirley Chisholm, Black women finding their voices in a world where they're not to be heard. Those are the ones who've inspired me at every turn.
Thank you for sharing those experiences and your truths and your again, being vulnerable. Same with you, Elle, for just sharing your connection to Chesley and how she inspired you and what that means to so many people. And that unique experience and you all, and that's bonding you all together, which is important. I'd love to transition to Mr. Boley and just kind of hear your thoughts.
Well, mine, not anybody famous, but the person that inspired me the most would be my dad. Growing up in Alabama in the 50s and 60s, I knew it was hard, but just going back to 2020, how that brought up a lot of conversations. I found out more about my dad in the last 2 years than I did my whole life. And just about how he grew up in Alabama during that time and the things that both he and his family had to endure and just so many obstacles they overcame. And it just, you know, just over the years, it's been like, wow, like, you know, I never knew that my dad didn't share so much about the hardships that, you know, both he, you know, he lost his parents at a young age. And so, you know, growing up around, you know, aunts and uncles, cousins, and man, it's just so much that it just inspired me to want to be better and also change my approach on life.
Thank you. And by the way, he is somebody famous. So thank you. He's special in all of our eyes. He upgraded you. So thank you. Absolutely. Brittany.
Oh, there we go. Two people who inspire me, and they're not you know, in our beginning of history. They're actually two individuals now. And they inspired me for various reasons. We have Olympic gold medalist Breonna Clark and also Armani Williams. Who are those two people? I'm going to tell you. Breonna Clark was diagnosed with autism. So she is a young Black girl who's dominating in the Olympics. She has won gold medals for the United States. She's also have won world championships. And then you look at Armani Williams, who is the first Black open NASCAR race car driver with autism. You know, so these two individuals truly inspire me because not only they're young and they're making strides in two predominantly white sports. Because if you look at history from the Olympics and you look at the statistics and the percentage of Black athletes opposed to white athletes, you will see who wins the most. And then you look at NASCAR, which has now within the last couple of years have become more diversified. But look at that, those two entities, and you look at these individuals who, like I said, are not only fighting those stereotypes and everything that comes along with this skin complexion, but they're also individuals with IDD. And they inspire me so much, not only as a mother and not only as an employee of Best Buddies, but also in my own walk with advocacy, you know, in my own professional sport of race car driving, when I'm advocating for individuals with special needs, because it gives you that inspiration to talk to our children who we are helping with this organization and let them know, hey, your disability does not define you. When I go around and I speak around the country and I do these keynote speakings, the label, and I'm gonna give it to you. So if y'all steal it, I'm gonna get all 100 and 200 of y'all on this Zoom. But my label of my speaking is called Stop Dissing Those with Disabilities. Stop focusing on their disabilities and focus on their abilities. So we need to start encouraging our Black and our Hispanic and our Indian children with IDD that we can do whatever we want to do. Black people, honey, I don't care what your disability are. You can do whatever you want to do. You know, you just have to apply yourself. So those are two individuals that truly inspire me, and they're taking that torch and they're running with it. And I'm truly honored to be in this generation to witness it.
There's so much that I could share after that statement, but I'll hold off till closing remarks. Thank you so much for all of you. This is Wylie. Love to hear from you.
All right. I know we're getting close, or we're actually over time, so I'll keep this really short. You know, I just follow up on everything that Michael said. You know, when I think about that one person, it's really hard, but the person that comes to mind is my dad. My dad is an architect. You know, he went to college in the 70s, and just hearing about his experience and the things that he had to overcome, and growing up with two parents that, you know, only had a high school, degree, or diploma, was really like challenging for him to go on and go to college. And for him, he's always been just a reminder to me that I can be that 1%. You know, when I was growing up, he was, you know, part of the 1% of Black architects across the country. You know, now it's 2%, but it's just been a constant reminder to me that I can be part of that 1%.
Wow. You all said quite a bit. And I appreciate you all for sharing your thoughts. And as I said to a few of you already, thank you for being vulnerable. And to all of you, thank you for being vulnerable. We're going to move forward because I know we're quite a bit with 9 minutes over. So what I'd like to do is open this up for Q&A briefly with all of our guests. We still have quite a few folks joining us. So thank you all for hanging in there with us. And we'll open it up for discussion. And so what we'd love to do is have you just put your questions in the chat to me or to Nicole, and then we can filter those questions into our panelists. You can ask them directly or through the chat, or you can actually turn your screens or your video and your audio on, and you can ask directly that way as well, whatever you're most comfortable with. Does anyone have a question at all? No questions, comments, thoughts? Okay. A lot of thank yous, you all. So I can say that. I think you can see some of that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to wait maybe another 30 seconds or 60 seconds, just kind of see whether someone's moved to ask a question. And then we'll, if we don't have any questions, we'll move to close out our program today. So it looks like I think we don't have any questions. Before we do that, what I will do is go ahead and ask you all the final closing questions for this panel. And I think it's going to be very helpful for our staff and anyone else. So earlier in our discussion, I asked you all about some of the barriers that may be faced. And what I'd like to do is to go back briefly and just touch on that one more time and just you spoke about opportunities as well. And then I think to close out, I'd love to really just get you all to think for a minute here if you could describe Black History Month in one word, what would that be? Take a moment, and then I will come around, I will go around and ask each of you, and then we'll close out our program today.
Hi, Joe.
Yes.
I don't have a Cardonia. Question.
Yes. Okay. Yes. No problem. How you doing?
I'm good. And you?
Great. Great. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. I don't have a question, but I do have a short thought.
Yes.
I think in terms of Best Buddies and Black History Month, I've sat here and I've listened to everyone share their stories and their views. And one thing I think that what Best Buddies does is helps people find their voice. I think Best Buddies tries to help people to defy the common norms and expectations, no matter what form they come in. And I think that so far, I think the trailblazers, the eye openers of our times, like Madam C.J. Walker and all the other ones, there is this fighting spirit to not take things lying down. Lastly, what I want to say is that so basically what I learned through a documentary, 1804, The Hidden History of Haiti, I noticed that there are a lot of people that when they got sick and tired of people just telling them what their place is, quote unquote, they decided that they were gonna step out of that and really fight for what every human being should have, their freedom and the right to be a person and to have views and opinions and stuff. So I think that's what I think Best Buddies tries to do. Just fight for people, but also giving people the tools to fight for themselves and to basically learn how to use their own voice.
Thank you. I couldn't agree more. I've been here a short time, nowhere near as long as you, but I am learning that that is who we are. It's a big part of why we were started, and I appreciate you using your voice during this panel discussion. Thank you.
If I may just interject, because I did see Cardonia's comment, and she was saying that she felt that Black women already had their voices. When I speak about Black women finding their voices, what I'm really speaking to is that we have lived in a society where for 400 plus years, women have been oppressed and marginalized, as Brittany was speaking to earlier. And so when I talk about finding your voice, it doesn't mean that you didn't have one. It just means that you were, you know, that you were in this society. We've been told our voices didn't matter. Even by Black men, our voices have not mattered. And so you have to kind of muster up that courage and that strength and then figure out who you are and what you want to say. That's what I mean by, you know, finding your voice. We're all constantly in pursuit of our best selves. We may already be that, but we're in constant pursuit of trying to find what more we are, how we want to show up in the world. That's what I was really speaking to.
Thank you. Thank you for adding to that. And I think clarifying what was shared today. Ms. Austin, thank you so much. I'd like to go around and start with Kelly. Kelly, if you could sum up Black History Month in one word, what would that word be?
Empowering. I feel like I learn a lot every time Black History Month rolls around. And like what someone said on the panel earlier, Black History Month is every month. I just don't think about it in February, but you're always great to educate yourself on what we can learn more of and what's not being taught in the textbook. So I just think it's very empowering.
Wow. Thank you.
Thank you.
Elle.
I would say reflection, time to reflect on where we started, where we are now, where we need to go, but also as some of the panelists touched on, what am I doing to better the world in itself and progress.
Reflection and power. Thank you.
I was channeling Kelly. I think I was channeling her because I was like empowering, but still, I'm right there with her. I would add invigorating. It just, okay, you know, gives me energy. When we come around this time, I'm just inspired to just keep next leveling it.
Awesome. Thank you. Mr. Boley.
Let me unmute myself. For me, celebratory, you know, it's, you know, not that, you know, like you said, you know, we have 11 other months, you know, as well. And for myself, you know, it's always a chance to learn more about a history. I love history, by the way. but you know, this is the month that, you know, not just for people of color, but for other peoples to be able to look back and learn more about every bit of American history and be able to celebrate, you know, the people from the past who have paved the way for today.
Thank you.
When I think of one word, and it's going to sound weird, but my word is triggering. When I think of Black History Month, I think of triggering. Why? Mm-hmm. Because it should trigger each and every one of us. It should trigger you to want to get more involved in your community. It should trigger you to want to learn more about Black history. And it's not Black history, it's American history. It's our history. So it should trigger you to want to do something. It should trigger you to want to, you know, focus more on equity, access, and attainment, and diversity, both in Best Buddies and also in your communities, whether you're in the city, whether you're in a rural environment, you know, it should trigger you. It should spark something inside of you. So that's what I think when I think of Black History Month. It is triggering, and that's exciting to me.
Agreed. Jessica.
The one word that comes to mind for me is culture. I just think that, you know, Black history is all about culture. I think you know, being Black is a culture, you know, so I think that that is like the one thing that comes to mind when I think about it, you know, in addition to several of the other words that have already been shared.
Thank you. Thank you all so much. I've thought about this question because I said I wouldn't be right if I didn't chime in and say something. And I think resourceful. Going to North Carolina A&T taught me a whole lot. I went to predominantly white schools in New York City, whether it be Catholic or a public school. And they were definitely diverse. It's New York City, but you didn't quite have to be as resourceful. A lot of things were right at your fingertips. But going to school in Greensboro, North Carolina was quite different. The internet was still not thriving yet. It was basically on a CD, but for those who remember AOL. And so that's going back to a different time. And you couldn't access the web the way you can now. You had to be resourceful. And I think that's what I take from our history, from my family's history, from those who came before me. I was welting tears a minute ago because I was thinking of the person who inspired me so much. His name was Jack Harper. He was a surgeon in New York City who taught me how to do multiplication. When my parents were at work and my siblings, we were trying to get some help after school, get babysitters. Well, he taught me my multiplication tables. He made sure I understood that. That built that energy, that triggering point that you spoke about, Brittany, that I think we should all be inspired by one another. We should all be inspired by the culture, by other people, by other races, by other people who dare to do something different. And I think that's what I think about Black history is. And there are many people who've been resourceful throughout history, who've impacted so many cultures, so many people's lives, those that have been advocates both in IDD space and beyond. We celebrate them. We celebrate them every single day, not just this month, not just today, but always. And I think for the staff that is still on the call, it is an absolute honor to have these panelists. Thank you all for your gifts, for your talents, for your hearts, for your vulnerability, and for your love and being here and sharing who you are as individuals, to your communities, to your families, to yourselves. Happy Black History Month, everyone. Thank you for being here with us. And it is American history, Brittany. I echo that and I celebrate that. It is about inclusion. That's who we are as an organization. That's who you all are. That's what you represent and what you shared today. Wylie and Nicole, could not do this without you. Thank you both for being resourceful. Thank you for your patience with me and getting this done. I celebrate you both. Celebrate everyone. Thank you for our leadership team and best buddies for providing, helping us to provide this platform for everyone. And Kelli, thank you for being an inspiration to us all. You have indeed been inspiring on this panel, and just being your authentic self. That is awesome. Back at you. Elle, thanks for joining us. Mike, thank you for being with us. Jennifer, Jessica, thank you for going through those barriers today to get here with us. And Brittany, thank you so much for your graciousness in joining us. Staff, thank you all so much. Have a great afternoon. Again, folks, happy Black History Month. A survey will go out and some resources that we'll share post-program. We'll see you all soon. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Bye, everyone.